Wednesday. I hope you all wore green. I did. Okay, so last time in Don't Feed the Bully, we were in Chapter 2, and it left us with a lot more questions than answers. So hopefully in Chapter 3, we will learn something else out. So I'm going to be starting in Chapter 3. That's a very interesting picture they have for Chapter 3. I headed out to the playground to sniff around for clues. William B. Travis's playground looked like any other. Kids mostly played with their own age groups, then splintered off like the cast of The Lion King. The monkey kids were climbing and swinging in endless loops. The Okapi kids, or chasers, ran after each other in perpetual circles. The grazers were standing in packs like groups of zebras gossiping. The players, who like any Serengeti cubs, played non-stop games, kickball, tetherball, or any other sports that satisfied their boundless energy stream and need for competition like headbutting rams. There were also the meerkats, the kids who scrambled nervously on the playground from end to end, just trying to keep out of everyone's way and trying to eke out an existence as the lowest arc on the circle of life. One big difference between William B. Travis and the rest of the world's elementary playgrounds was the King of Beasts had been defeated, dethroned, and didn't seem to care. Ralphie sat alone on a step. On the top of Pride Rock was Kurt Pesterman. Here, the Lion King reference ends because Kurt was no Scar. He was a meerkat, but a meerkat who figured a way to crush the societal evolution and mold his own reality. He didn't even have any hyenas for help. The other bigger sixth grade boys who outside this bizarro world would have lorded over the domain, with Ralphie as king, had shrunken away and avoided him like he was wearing skunk perfume. Yet they were not aligning themselves with Kurt either. Kurt ruled alone and needed no army to hold power. Even the other meerkats steered clear of him. Kurt was a hard guy to like. I would have thought the labeled geeks, nerds, and dorks would have crawled out of the woodwork for a chance to taste the power a predator-free landscape had to offer. I was more puzzled than my mom with an Xbox. From behind me, I heard a small, high-pitched throat clearing, softly, as if only partly sure it wanted attention. I turned around and ran into a smile so cute that my optic nerves had to squeeze tight to hold my eyeballs in my head. The only thing that kept me conscious was that men in my family are late bloomers, and the hormones that make adolescent boys slobbering boneheads around girls were at least 4 years away. Hello? I stammered, hoping she heard more of the hello and less of the wow. Hi, she said in a voice that could make a choir angels give up and become mimes. I'm a Kayla. The fact that she was as nervous as I was brought my strength back to normal, but I could still feel the gnawing of puppy love grinding away my common sense. Handy? I replied with a small squeak. That made it sound like a question. At what? Kayla said, confused, as I mentally slapped my palm onto my forehead. I cleared my throat. No, I mean Handy is what people call me. It's short for Hannibal. That was better. Oh, hello, Handy, she said, looking as if she should maybe quickly invent a time machine and go back in time about 45 seconds. Don't worry, I said. I am a whiz at second impressions. Kayla relaxed a little bit. You made a good impression when you walked into class this morning, she continued. You handled yourself very well with Kurt. Thanks, I said, and dove off the high dive. Why is everyone so afraid of Kurt? Kayla's eyes drooped, and I could see I had moved too fast, destroying any chance of real questions. Kayla recovered her composure quickly and smiled another cutie pie smile, albeit a more melancholy one. You seem like a nice and smart kid, Handy, she said. Like my little brother. Little brother, I thought. Ouch. That spelled doom for an 11-year-old's version of romance. I'd keep playing the humble new kid and just do your homework. Oh, wait. I'd keep playing the humble new kid and just do your homework, Kayla said, and she began to turn away. Kayla, I said, wondering what she meant by homework. You came up to me for a reason. Maybe I can help. Kayla turned back. I don't need help. Kayla responded with a knowing squint in her eyes that signaled many people did need help. I can see that.
I just wanted to say welcome to William B. Travis,
she said as she floated away, a pixie from Neverland, and me out of dust and low on good thoughts. The bell rang with an anemic thud, and we all ambled, ran, or plodded back to class. A creepy feeling crawled up my spine as my peripheral vision caught a glimpse of burning Hazel. Kurt was eyeballing me harder than a crazed fan at the Oscars from across the four-score court. I pretended not to notice and walked in with some of the kickball crowd to see about playing a little shortstop. Kurt was smart, and I think dangerous. His look meant I had better watch my step. And there we have it. There is Chapter 3. What did you guys think? How did you feel about Kayla? Did you want her to respond? How did you think she would have responded if she had been free to actually talk? Why do you think Kurt rules the school all by himself? Is he really helping, or could he be the bully instead of Ralphie? Let me know what you guys think down below. I hope you're having a good time on our NTI days, and I hope you're taking advantage of our good weather and you're playing outside. I know I have been. I walked Taz today, and hopefully I'll give him another walk this afternoon. I love you all. See you in a little bit. Bye, guys.